This video contains everything you need to know if you're an international high school or college student wanting to attend MIT, Caltech, Stanford, CMU, or any other top-tier technical school in the United States. In this video, I'm going to reveal a loophole that might enable you to get into these schools without having to be a complete genius, nor having perfect grades. So make sure not to miss this by watching the whole video. There is so much information out there about college admissions, but most of these tips and tricks don't really apply to you if you're an international student. These numbers apply to Americans only. Also, I'll make a separate video talking about PhD admissions, as they are a completely different story. This video will be divided into three parts. Firstly, I'm going to discuss the statistics specifically for international students. Then, I'm going to talk about how you can maximize your chances of getting admitted to MIT. And lastly, I'm going to have a discussion with three classmates who successfully got admitted as international students from Europe, Asia, and Latin America. If you're new to this channel, I'm an international PhD student at MIT, and I have friends in the admissions department. Also, consider subscribing to my channel so you don't miss any new videos coming out about startups, internships, top-tier university admissions, and other topics. Let's start with some numbers. As the world's population keeps growing, more and more high school students apply to university. At the same time, MIT continues being ranked the number one university in the world. Therefore, unfortunately, we're seeing a drop in the acceptance rates. For American applicants in 2008, the acceptance rate has been hovering at around 12%. Now, just 14 years later, this dropped down to just over 4%. For internationals, this is even worse. The acceptance rate has been just 1%. Yes, only 123 out of the over 9,000 international applicants got admitted last year. From my observations and interactions, these 123 students can be split into two groups. The first, in very small group, are exceptional geniuses. Students who either won gold medals at the International Physics and Math Olympiad, or some kids who graduated from high school by the age of 12. This is a very small group and I've never been in it. The second group out of these 123 students are kind of regular smart people. So they typically had good grades in high school, did something that made them stand out, had good scores at a standardized test, and lastly, they got a little bit lucky to get in. This brings us to the second part of this video. I'll give you some tricks to maximize your chances of getting into MIT. The nice thing about MIT's admission process is that they look at you as a whole person, not just the numbers you represent on the page. Obviously, good grades and test scores are very important, but they alone will not get you into MIT. You've got to stand out somehow. Furthermore, MIT doesn't have any unfair legacy admissions, which is something you can often see in schools such as Harvard or University of Pennsylvania, where having affluent or alumni parents will easily tenfold your chances of getting admitted.
I went to an Ivy League school. I'm very highly educated. I know words, I have the best words.
First off, you've got to find out what you're truly passionate about. This can be research, internships, science, or maybe some kind of sports competitions. But it is important that you get really good at something, then stand out with it. MIT as an academic institution is doing cutting-edge research, anything from cancer research to AI, and students have the opportunity to join labs very early on in their studies. Therefore, if you have previous research experience, this is going to go really into your advantage. Science and math Olympiads are also a very good way to showcase your talent. Many international undergrads at MIT have won some kind of competition in that area. The most recognized competitions are the International Physics Olympiad, Math, Informatics, and Chemistry. If you win a gold medal from any of these, you're almost guaranteed to get into this school or any other top school. But even a bronze medal is a very, very good advantage. Feel free to comment down below if you have any questions about these competitions or if you know about any other competitions that might really help. Another key thing to talk about is timing. You should plan well in advance what you want to do, then optimize everything you do in your life, including internships, research, etc., to build up a resume that will get you where you want to go. The best time to start to do this is right now. Next up, school experience in the US. Doing a semester or a year abroad in the US will significantly boost your chances of getting admitted. Whether it's a high school exchange or an exchange during your bachelor's degree, there are a lot of interesting programs that can support you, such as the Rotary International. I'll put a link in the description. Here's a little loophole. And no, this is not yet the big loophole that I announced at the beginning of the video. Sports competitions. I know what you're thinking. Maybe MIT may not be as much into sports such as Stanford or Harvard, but a coach at MIT can still give you that final push to get you admitted. When I was in high school, I was really good at triathlon. I even won a national championship in triathlon in Croatia. Therefore, I reached out to an MIT coach and see if I could get supported as a student athlete. Here's a real email from MIT's head coach. As you can see, triathlon is not an official sport at MIT, but track and field is. So what he told me is essentially that if I was able to run 5 kilometers in less than 16 minutes, he would be able to put a small request to the admissions department for me. This may sound quite challenging, but with a few years of training, it's not actually that hard to reach. Unfortunately, as I started training for many hours per day, I injured my leg and ultimately couldn't make it. On a more positive note, here's a discussion with my international classmates who successfully got admitted to MIT.
Hi, I'm Arbri. I'm a second year student studying biological engineering, and I'm from Shkodra, Albania. Right now, I'm researching cancer genetics, which is pretty cool.
Hi, my name is Gracia. I'm from Guadalajara, Mexico. I did my undergrad at MIT in physics and ECS. I'm currently doing my master's.
Hello, I'm Lei. I'm from Kota, India. I'm an undergraduate senior studying computer science and economics.
Hello, my name is Penguin. I'm from Antarctica. And I study electrical engineering at MIT. I'm so smart.
Does anyone have a pencil?
A pencil?
I feel so more comfortable with a pencil.
Amazing.
He's like...
Oh, an Apple pencil.
Yes. Melissa, that's what I thought.
So thank you guys so much for being here. I'm very glad that you made it on this weekend. And I'm really curious to hear your stories about how you got into MIT and like a general overview of all the international people that you know here, how they got into MIT.
Before MIT, I did math in high school. So being from Albania, it's, I think, easier to be part of national teams. And I also did one exchange year in St. Louis in Missouri, so here in the US for my senior year of high school. And I think that gave me a lot of perspective. So then coming to MIT was a bit easier, I think, than it would normally be.
Oh, nice. So you were at the IMO, the Math Olympiad.
That's right.
Which year?
2019. It was Bath, the UK.
In the UK. So how did you like it? How long did you have to prepare for even getting there?
It took a while. When I think about it, I think it was worth it, but it was so much work. But then when I got there, I should have done a lot more work. Just the people were very cool and the experience was very awesome. So getting to know everyone. And then the coolest thing is that some of the people I met there, I thought I was never going to see again, like Alessandra. But then I have them in my classroom here at MIT. It's pretty cool.
Gracia, let's move on to you. Can you tell us about your story and where you're from?
Yeah. Hi, I'm Gracia. I'm from Mexico. And I did physics and math when I was in high school. And well, my story was sort of similar. I think a lot of international kids who get into MIT, it's because they did like international Olympiads. So I went to IPHO as well. I did 2016 in Zurich and 2017 in Indonesia. So yeah,
oh, nice.
It was definitely a big part of it. I did not do an exchange here in the US, so definitely moving to MIT was like my first time.
Your first
in the
time.
US. Yeah, I had traveled to a lot of other countries for competitions, but not to the US. But I think it was hard to adapt, especially when you're surrounded by all these Olympian kids.
So Lei, do you want to tell us your story, where you're from?
Yeah, I'm Lei, I'm from India. And when I was in high school, I also did Olympiads. I was focusing on physics. I went to the IFO and the Asian Physics Olympiad. The IFO was 2017 and 2016. Many people I know were there. Gracia was there. That's who I first met Gracia.
Oh, you know each other from before.
Yeah, it's
from
crazy.
Nice.
And none of us knew that they were going to MIT, I think.
Yeah. It's crazy.
I had no idea I would apply to MIT before going to the Olympiads, but then I saw many people who were applying to US universities, so I thought it was a good idea and maybe I should give it a try.
Amazing. Yeah. So all three of you went to physics / math Olympiads, but you met quite a lot of undergrads who got into MIT as internationals. How many of them are like non-Olympiads? How many of them got in another way? Do you have like any interesting stories?
Something that I think is not a pattern, but at least what I have seen for people that didn't do Olympiads as internationals, they usually tend to have explored different countries. So I know, I believe, three people from the Balkans area in particular that lived in Europe and then went to school in Europe for high school or middle school and are accustomed to that diversity of thought and of work experience. So I think that's also something that colleges tend to look for.
Well, I'd rather not to point to specific names, but I know what sort of projects they do to get into MIT without like necessary having like a strong Olympiad curriculum. So I know there's like a lot of summer schools in US universities. So those are pretty prestigious. People have to apply and have like a very, very outstanding scores in high school. So they go to these exchange programs, summer schools, and I even know people who are entrepreneurs. So like I even know people who have their startups like
out
of high school.
Wow.
And then they get into MIT because of that. I actually know a few successful people who had to delay their offers for like a year or two to keep working on their companies and then coming to MIT. So that's it's really impressive.
So they're like 17 years old and already have some companies?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Or at least they have ideas or they have pitched their projects. They have gone through some later stages. So MIT really takes that into account. Also, something that I forgot to mention is that I think that's it's harder to get an opportunity as a high school student, but there's a lot of people who were able to get good research opportunities.
Okay.
Like that was not really my case, but I know people who have like even published or at least worked in like some big projects doing research. And that's probably even more tangible than going to Olympiad. So, well, we went to Olympiad because
oh, yeah, for sure.
That's something we were able to do.
So thank you guys so much for participating in this conversation.
Thank you for having us.
All right, are you guys hungry?
Are you recording that?
Oh, I'm the guest. That was a weird moment. Let's use the comment section down below as a discussion forum so everybody can read and benefit from my reply. As promised, here is the major loophole that could get you admitted into MIT, Stanford, Harvard, or any other top school. Master's degrees. Getting into undergraduate or PhD programs at these schools can be ridiculously hard, but getting admitted into a master's program can be much easier for an international. The thing is that the number of spots for international applicants is very limited if you're applying for a bachelor's degree, but for a master's degree this limit is either very high or non-existent at all. You can get into many master's degree programs without having any crazy first author publications or fancy internship experiences. Having said that, keep in mind that as a PhD student, you usually get paid, while as a master's student, you have to pay. Master's degrees aren't cheap, but if you can do a master's degree at one of the best universities in the world, it's usually worth every penny. Even if you don't get lucky and don't get any financial support from the university nor family, it's often even worth taking a loan for it. The amount of connections and better job opportunities you might get later will easily let you repay these loans. The admission process can be rather soul-sucking given all the bias and randomness that is involved in the process and completely out of your control. Nevertheless, I hope that this video gave you some valuable insights and you learned something new. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to my channel over here. I wish you best of luck with your academic journey. Goodbye.
Hi, I'm Leh. I'm from Kota, India, and I'm an undergraduate senior studying computer science and economics.
So Gracie, I wonder, how did the Penguin get into MIT?
Yeah, well, the admissions committee realized that there was very low representation from Antarctica, and this guy got in as being the best swimmer.
Wait, we don't have audio.
I was so ready.